I mean, the SEC themselves haven't really said, well, they know for sure that XRP is a security. In their own court filings, they've said that the court will determine that, which of course brings a contradiction that if the court's going to determine that, how could I personally have known that the SEC would view XRP as a security? I've seen actually people on Twitter talk about this. You know, I want closure. I want clarity. You know, for people who have followed this before the lawsuit, you know, I've been saying for at least a couple of years that we have lacked clarity in the United States. In contrast, you've got major economies around the world like the UK, like Japan, like Switzerland, like Singapore. I mean, these are not, you know, really small economies. These are big economies with robust government infrastructure that have provided the clarity, that have allowed entrepreneurs, that have allowed those that would choose to speculate in digital assets to do so with that clarity and certainty. And here in the United States, we haven't had that. And so, you know, someone had said, well, maybe there's a, I'm quoting a Twitter tweet roughly, you know, someone had said, well, you know, if they walk away from the case, we won't have the certainty we've been looking for. You know, maybe we want to keep the case, you know, we want to get to the closure. And I kind of agree with that. You know, if we've been asking for that for 2 or 3 years, you know, we're now, for better or for worse, we're on a path to get it. And it's unfortunate it has to come from the courts. For better or for worse, the SEC has not gone through the rulemaking processes that would provide the certainty even for Bitcoin or Ether. And, you know, one of the reasons why I said when the SEC first filed this lawsuit that this was an attack on crypto is because if you're going to say that about XRP, you know, where is that dark line where this is and that isn't? And I think as more and more people are finding, you know, that it's a slippery slope. You know, even last week, I think Barry Silbert came out and said it would be, I'm paraphrasing here, but roughly speaking, he said that it would be dangerous for US exchanges to unhalt or relist XRP. And, you know, at the same time, he was removing XRP from one of his funds, but adding Chainlink, I think. Well, the clarity doesn't exist for Chainlink. Clarity, you know, it's one of these like, well, wait a minute, did you really think through all of that? And it's one of the reasons why we have tried to, you know, really educate the crypto market at large that this isn't good for the whole crypto industry.
Right.
And, you know, really, I think, how do we all work together and help create legislation, help create that clarity and that certainty? So my ideal outcome, clarity and certainty are first amongst them. You know, how do we get there? Well, as quickly as possible, I want to get there with the SEC so that Ripple can operate effectively, so that lots of other companies that are operating in the XRP ecosystem can operate with that clarity and certainty. But, you know, at this point, given they have decided, they did decide to file the lawsuit, I think we need to either reach a clear settlement that provides that clarity and certainty or let the judge make that decision.
Sure. And do you see another avenue, let's say the SEC can't get their act together for whatever reason, that Congress has to step in here with a token taxonomy act or change the law or President Biden, whatever, just something happens on that front. Do you see that as a possibility as well?
Oh, for sure. Zero doubt about that. I mean, you know, when there aren't clear laws, it's Congress's job to provide clearer laws. And, you know, to the extent I have anything nice to say about the SEC today, you know, there is a rulemaking process through which they could go about. They chose not to do that and use enforcement as a way to try to create clarity, which I think is extremely inefficient and, you know, really bad for, in this case, Ripple and really the entire XRP community. But, you know, there was something called the Digital Commodity Exchange Act introduced in the last session of Congress and in the, I think, Agricultural Committee. I hope that either that or something very similar, and I'm not sure anything's been introduced yet, but I expect there will be new efforts to solve this through legislation. And I think that could be even a more efficient path than what we're dealing with through the court system, because the court system will make a determination, assuming it gets all the way there, about XRP and did Ripple engage, or did I personally, or Chris Larson personally engage in selling unregistered securities? But that won't solve the problem for everyone else. It'll provide a precedent. But really, I think, you know, if we could get clarity through legislation, that could be very powerful for the whole industry. And by the way, one more thing, and I know I'm rambling, but just bear with me one sec. You know, having been a student of the internet back in the late 90s, one of the reasons why the United States was such a early investor and leader in the internet technologies and companies around it is because there was that clarity. There was certainty. Sure. And when you have those things, investors and entrepreneurs come into those markets. And instead, what we have here in the United States, we don't have those things. And so you see a lot of that happening outside of the United States, which I think is unfortunate, you know, for here in the United States. You mentioned the UK having this, a very clear tax, you know, Token Taxonomy Act or something like that. You know, that really differentiate different assets by use case. Which I think is, you know, did provide leadership in the UK. And I think Singapore has provided a lot of leadership, in Japan as another example. I do believe there are many compelling use cases. There are many compelling vertical opportunities, vertical markets to apply blockchain technologies to. And the XRP ledger is an extremely efficient blockchain. And so there's many other use cases that we think about, and we think we could apply our expertise in enterprise sales, as well as the efficiency of the XRP ledger, to solve some of those problems. And so I'm excited about, you know, what I think will be ahead. You know, we're almost 500 people strong, and trying to hire 150 or 200 people through from now until the end of the year. So we're still certainly in the face of, you know, some headwinds from the United States SEC. We're still investing heavily in growing. Everyone who follows Ripple closely and follows the XRP community closely can appreciate, when we're working with particularly large banks, really any customer, you know, we try to respect, you know, any announcements to respect what they want to announce, when they want to announce it, things like that. And so that sometimes that's frustrating for us. You know, I remember there was a certain patent filing that came from one large bank that referenced Ripple in a certain way, and of course generated a lot of questions, and I didn't have much to say about that. You know, there was some attention, you know, because some central bankers' schedules are public information. I've seen that the rumors out there. I'm going to go back to what I said earlier. The XRP ledger is extremely efficient. It's extremely scalable, and you can issue other assets on the XRP ledger. And so I have said publicly, you know, we often are asked by central banks to come and talk to them about whether it's the XRP ledger or about, you know, how we think about the future of payments using digital assets. And, you know, because of our unique position with, you know, really compelling technology and the ability to offer a private version of, you know, the open source technology as XRP ledger, you know, central banks can manage and create and manage their own digital currencies.